We live in a time where our culture, and by consequence our entertainment and our art, has accelerated the rate of self-reference to a point where we can't even keep up anymore. Our cycle of self-referencing used to be a matter of decades or even centuries, but now we have days, months, maybe a year before we're talking about what we did with either criticism or nostalgia. We have reboot upon reboot upon reboot in television and movies, and a meme on the internet can go from genuine to ironic to post-ironic in a blink of an eye. The consumption rate for new content is so high because we just need something new right now that it becomes very difficult to have new story ideas that are bold and have a sense of craftsmanship to them. But amid all of that self-referential chaos, this comic is a breath of fresh air. Howdy, I'm Kurt Williams, and today we're looking at issue one of The Nice House by the Sea by James Tynion IV, Alvaro Martinez Bueno, and Jordi Belair. This is a follow-up series to The Nice House by the Lake, which was one of my favorite series as it was coming out, and I've been very tempted to buy a hardcover edition, even though I already have the whole thing in floppies. I am regularly very impressed with James Tynion. I love The Deviant, I love Department of Truth, and of course, Something is Killing the Children is another modern classic, but these series also stand out to me quite a bit because I think that these are some of James Tynion's most articulate and compelling writing. If you haven't read these series, here's the main gist. This guy is Walter. In the first series, he invited a bunch of his old friends to this weekend getaway at this very nice house on a lake, and once they get there, they find out that outside their lake house, the world is ending. Walter is an alien who's been pretending to be human for a long time so that he could find the best candidates for his alien race to study after they've destroyed Earth. And even though these 12 people can get anything they want in this lake house and Walter has saved them from death, they just don't like it. You can't really put someone in a cage and expect them not to try to get out. And that's what these 12 issues of The Nice House on the Lake were about, these characters trying to test their limits and get out of their cage, and at the very end of the series they decided that the best way for them to have free will, or what was left of their free will, was to kill Walter so at least they don't have a jailer and they're in control of their fate inside this cage. However, Walter knew that they were going to do that, of course, so he just pretended that he died and now he's running things from outside their perceptions. Or maybe they are actually in control of their house, but they don't really understand the full situation, because as we find out at the very end of that last issue, there are other houses, and these houses are in competition with each other to see who will actually survive. Now, I know that some of you are thinking, oh, he made this out to be very fresh, but these are all ideas that I'm very familiar with. These are kind of common tropes. And you're right, it is a post-apocalyptic sci-fi story, and it does have an element of alien simulation, and it does have an element of last man standing. These are all very common themes in stories, but this is still a very modern, fresh take on those themes. The first thing that jumps out at me about the writing in these stories is that it has so much potential to be cliche, but it's not. We have this grand, dramatic premise with this deep sense of finality and even doom to it, but it's not just over-dramatic the whole time. The dialogue keeps us grounded with a whole spectrum of emotions, including funny moments that are not overdone. And when it comes to the dialogue in particular, the really great thing about James Tynion is that he uses modern vernacular and sentence structures in a way that doesn't seem trite, but seems true to the characters while also supporting itself from the standpoint of literature. Here's an example. We have Oliver say, "I actually used to take people out on dates and ask them the question, how would you spend your last day on Earth? And you know I'd take notes on the best ideas." So starting a sentence with "and you know" is not grammatically correct, but it is the way that people talk, so we can immediately identify with this character because he speaks like us. But, and this is the important part, he doesn't overdo it. We don't have that kind of phrasing throughout the whole book. We still have plenty of time for characters to speak with purpose and weight. We still have a variety of sentence structures that convey depth and meaning. Like Brian Michael Bendis has a very specific dialogue style that felt very natural and therefore was very popular because it felt fresh, but when you pile it on and you don't vary it with different voices and different tones, then it just gets kind of thin. So to sum all that up, this is a story with familiar themes, but is told with a very fresh, balanced voice. And that's the best you can hope for with storytelling, honestly. There's not really any new ideas out there, just new ways of expressing those ideas. But the really, really great thing about this series is the art. Just look at that art. It is gorgeous and striking. Look at that. That is a painting. That should be on a wall somewhere, celebrated as high art. Look at that. You can feel the sun on your skin. Bueno is doing an excellent job, and Jordi Belair is just crushing it with these colors. And this two-page spread where we slowly see it start to rain harder and harder and we get all these very moody portraits of all the characters. Oh, that's amazing! Throughout most of the issue, the art is so moody and textured and soft that when we finally get the colors that have to do with the alien creatures, it's very disorienting. On this page, we've got a lot of grays and blues and browns. It's very withheld, kind of soft. And then we turn the page and get this absolutely jarring, psychedelic rainbow. And just look at these textures. Every time anything alien is drawn, it's so disorienting and beautiful and just insane. Every single page has something gorgeous on it. There's not a single page on here that doesn't seem well realized. And here's another thing that's amazing about it. There are very few artists working in the industry today who are good actors. If you want to draw body language and facial expressions in a way that has instant depth of emotion, then you have to understand acting. Because to the untrained eye, it might look like an actor is just standing there delivering their lines, but there's a big difference between your dad standing on a stage delivering lines and Patrick Stewart standing on stage delivering lines. There are all these subtle details that when you add them together, you get this dramatic sense of tone and presence and moment, and some artists can capture that. Alvaro Martinez Bueno is definitely one of those artists. Look at this, for example. We have a head tilt, we have the eyebrows and the eyelids doing something very specific, we have the shoulders slightly raised, you get a very strong sense of his emotion there. Or look at this expression. We have just enough of a smile, we have that side eye so he looks devious, slightly amused, but also with drawn from the situation and contemplative. Plenty of artists out there are a lot like child actors. They have these big movements that have big emotion. They're too dramatic. They're too dynamic. It's very blunt. It's like screaming your emotions through a megaphone. Whereas Bueno is the seasoned, very carefully measured screen actor who knows that less is more and relies on subtleties to convey a much deeper emotion. And now that I've gushed about all this art for so long, I'm realizing that I haven't even told you about the plot of this series yet. But honestly, I kind of don't feel like I need to. You know that it's a post-apocalyptic sci-fi story, and you know that it's a great work of art, so really, what else do you need to know? Just go buy it. So I'm gonna give issue 1 of The Nice House by the Sea a 10 out of 10. I honestly don't know how it could get better. I think every single part of this comic is done with excellence. So make sure you pick it up from your local comic shop, and if you read it, what did you think?